So ladies and gentlemen, please will you give Todd a really, really big welcome.
Wow, what a bag full of energy there is in this room. Amazing. I've just hitched up from London. I had four lifts on the way up, and they were absolutely perfectly synchronized. Did I arrive in the nick of time, or would you say I had time to spare?
Well, it was actually perfect timing because we were setting up at that time, yes. So we picked him up actually from Blackburn, which is just down the road from Burnley.
It's all about, as far as I'm concerned these days, not just trusting these authentic instincts, but then acting on them, having the courage to act, because ultimately, without our own direct actions, we only have belief systems, we don't have truth. We only access truth through our own direct experiences. Reading books is fantastic, it'll inspire us. Hearing people talk, great. Ultimately, it's just belief systems. So I do like to kind of, talk my walk and walk my talk, whichever way it goes, just get out there. And the reason I hitchhike is it gives me an opportunity to access synchronicity on a regular basis. And I just got back from a week-long hitchhiking adventure in Cornwall, where I had some really powerful synchronicities, and I had someone with me that was traveling, and they'd never experienced synchronicity on this level before. I think they were a little bit frightened, to be honest, at the end of it, especially when this little UFO battle took place one night about 12 midnight, and we were in the middle of this farmer's field, and it was really weird stuff. I'd never seen anything like it, but maybe if we get talking about non-human intelligences, ET, at some point during this talk, then maybe I'll share that at some point. Well. So, tonight we're going to cover the multidimensional universe, so therefore our multidimensional nature and our multidimensional heritage. We're going to talk about the true nature of the soul, how soul contracts fit into our lives and how things like fate, destiny, free will, karma, reincarnation, all is packaged together with these soul contracts. We're going to talk about all of these non-physical fields of reality that can be experienced, whether through the dream state or through the out-of-body state. So we'll cover the first dimension outside of the physical reality, which is the dimension a lot of people experience when they have a spontaneous out-of-body experience. We'll talk about the astral planes and how every single religion on this planet is speaking truth to some degree or another. This is all very thought-responsive, the non-physical reality. In the non-physical fields, a thought equals an action. So if you can imagine all the collective thoughts of all the Christians on the planet, creating in the non-physical reality, in the astral planes, their version of heaven. But ultimately, it's not the ultimate destination. It's just another aspect of this overall illusion. So we'll cover aspects of the astral plane, the higher planes of consciousness, where you can not only find more evolved beings and non-human intelligences that are here and keeping an eye on what's taking place, our kind of development of human consciousness. So we'll talk about that, and if anybody wants to ask a question about maybe ascension, quite happy to do that. And then, of course, the soul plane, which is very integral to this overall journey. Now, when I was a child, same as I'm sure for most of you, I had a lot of really bizarre experiences and started remembering this stuff at a very early age, 7, 8 years old. And I get quite worked up on some of these experiences, and my mother started coming in at night and calm me down, and she actually kept notes of all the experiences that I was having, and I guess it's part of the process to help calm me down over a period of time. When I left home at age 17, she presented this kind of fat, thick folder of all these documents, and I asked her, I said, what's all that about? Because I think all of it started trailing off around age 12, and I'd completely forgotten about it. And she handed me this big folder, and she said, this is all your experiences that I documented when you were a kid, and I was bowled over. I couldn't believe that I had this mother that had the wherewithal to kind of document all of these experiences that I had, whether they were just dreams or whether they were something more. And it kind of kept me busy for some of the years that I was traveling, reading through it all and just accessing this information that was just, as far as I was concerned, buried in my subconscious and maybe never to be seen again. So that was quite cool. About 5 years ago, I was doing something called remote viewing, and I was teaching remote viewing, and I was a very active remote viewer. Remote viewer is just clairvoyance, steeped in science, a scientific protocol to help keep the psychic very honest and help allow the psychic to replicate results again and again. This was something that was born out of military programs in the 1970s to keep tabs on the Soviets' psychic spying program. So it was all quite interesting stuff. 5 years ago, I was very political, and I was very conspiracy orientated. And then suddenly, the out-of-body stuff came onto the scene. One of the most popular remote viewers in the world is named Joseph McMoneagle. And I was reading his last book, which is called The Stargate Chronicles. And in this book, he mentions the Monroe Institute in Virginia and the Gateway Experience, and how people go to the Institute and they sit this in-house course, and they have out-of-body experiences. I thought, wow, I'm sure I've had some spontaneous experiences. I'd love to be able to do that at will. So I went online and I found that you could actually order this Gateway Experience for a home study course. It's 18 CDs in total. So I was very excited. I ordered that. It arrived a few weeks later, and reading through the material, it said it must, you know, it's to be used in a sequential order and to take your time with it, maybe take 2 months. But I'm a very impetuous type, so I thought, no way, I'm going to blow through this in 2 weeks. And the Gateway CDs are based on Hemisync technology. Hemisync is where you listen with headphones and you have this binaural beat where one specific sound goes in the right ear that affects the left brain hemisphere, and then one beat that goes in the left ear that affects the right brain. And those two distinct signals will then create a third signal, and that will then harmonize and give you this whole brain activity, so synchronize both hemispheres. This whole brain activity is what monks spend years and years and years through meditation to achieve these deep trance states. With the Hemisync technology, you can achieve these deep trance states in a matter of 10-15 minutes. So it's very powerful stuff. So I got my home study course, thought, yes, I'm going to just blow right on through this. Put my headphones on, lay down on my couch by 11 o'clock at night, and Robert Monroe's voice came over for the voiceover. Robert Monroe's done about 40 years of out-of-body experiences. He's no longer physically with us, but he's considered the modern pioneer of out-of-body exploration. So listening to his nice soothing voice, and suddenly I wake up about 8 o'clock in the morning and think, what the hell was that? I mean, I literally fell asleep. I don't remember anything on the CD. So I thought, okay, fine. Powerful technology, I get it. I'm with you. So at 10, 11 o'clock at night again, put the headphones on, lie down on the couch, Mr. Monroe graces my company, and sticking with him. Again, I wake up about 7, 8 o'clock in the morning thinking, what the hell is going on? Can't be that powerful. So I, after about a week, learned great respect for Hemisync technology, and I did progress through at the pace that they recommend, about 2 months. I continued to use the Hemisync for a period of a year. Didn't have any phenomenal results, as in a fully conscious out-of-body experience, but it's only the last three CDs in the 8-CD course, which is dedicated specifically to the out-of-body state. The first 15 CDs is a complete resource for kind of accessing consciousness and exploring consciousness, and I guess the last three CDs are just the pinnacle of that. So nothing really tremendous happened on the out-of-body scene for that year. A year later, I came across a book titled Adventures Beyond the Body by a man named William Buhlman. And William Buhlman, like Robert Monroe, started having experiences in his kind of 20s. And reading his book, I just thought, wow, I don't think I could ever come across a more transparent mentor. He goes from a very atheist belief system, where he's having a chat with a friend over a fence one day, and this neighbor shares the story of how he's used a few techniques to get out of his body and explore the local neighborhood at night. And so Buhlman was quite interested in that and asked the friend for the techniques. Buhlman spent about 30 days practicing these every night, and finally 30 days later he had his first conscious OBE. And so he starts off his book with that atheist perspective, and then he goes on for about three chapters with his diary entries for that first few years, and then he goes on to bridge science and spirituality in a very coherent way. So I highly recommend this book. So also in his book, there's a good 50 different techniques. So I thought, wow, this will be good, because I'm not getting out of the body. I'm using the Hemisync. A lot of people have had results with it, but I came to find out that Hemisync is not the only thing that a lot of people are going to need to give them that extra kind of boost to catapult them out of the body. So I started using William Buhlmann's techniques as well. And at that same exact time period, I contracted poison ivy. I had poison ivy, these rashes all over my arms, my torso, my legs. And it went on for weeks with all this itching. And one night, I woke up about 5 o'clock in the morning, and I just couldn't stay asleep. So I got up, I went downstairs, put calamine lotion all over me, laid down on the couch, got the hemisync out. I thought, I'm going to try my best to use the hemisync to escape, even if it's just getting into a light, medium trance, maybe then using William Buhlmann's techniques to see if I can get out of my body and just get away from all this itching and this pain. So I was doing that for about an hour, and I must have just lost consciousness when suddenly these vibrations just roared through, these non-physical vibrations. My whole body was just absolutely vibrating. And I got so excited, it brought me to full waking consciousness, and I was completely excited thinking, I've read all about this, I know what these are. Monroe talks about these, Buhlmann talks about these, everybody talks about these vibrations on the forum, about this being a precursor to a possible out-of-body experience. So I thought to myself, okay, they seem strong, as strong as people say they need to be. I wonder if I could just sit up, I wonder if I could just sit up out of my physical body. So I had that thought, and I just sat forward without any sort of muscle, using any sort of muscle, and surprisingly, I was kind of dangling halfway out of my physical body. And at that point, this white light flooded into the room, and this hand reaches down through the light, and I was like, whoa, where did that come from? And I wasn't really prepared for that, I was a bit shocked by it. And so I laid down back into my physical body, trying to disengage from the experience. And fair enough, soon enough, the hand withdrew, the light withdrew, and I was left there in my lounge in the dark. And I thought, you idiot. 1 year, all of this practicing, and somebody shoves a hand through a bit of light, and I get a little bit freaked out, so. Okay, calm down. Let's see if we can get these vibrations to come back. So I spent the next few minutes thinking about what I just experienced, staying relaxed, not moving my physical body, and soon enough, these vibrations came back, and they felt even stronger, more intense than they were before. And so I thought, once again, I wonder if I can just sit back out of my physical body again. So I did. I sat back up, and there I was dangling out. And once again, light flooded into the room. Hand came through the light. I was a little bit hesitant, but I thought, oh, what the hell? Come on. So I reached out, grabbed the hand with my non-physical hand, and it pulled me straight away from my physical body. The light and the hand both withdrew, and I stood there in my lounge, hovering over my physical body. And it was the most magical moment of my life up to that moment. Mm-hmm. I thought, you know, how special to validate that I actually am more than my physical body. You know, we all feel in our hearts, you know, this deep nature of who and what we really are, the soul. But to experience this non-physical essence for myself was quite powerful. And I thought to myself, it was a very quick journey. I was back in body before I knew it. But for most newbies to the out-of-body stuff, it is usually a very quick journey in and out for those first few experiences. After that, I just ramped up my practice and I became so incredibly motivated. It only took me a week to have my second conscious out-of-body experience. By the third week, I was having 3 and 4 experiences in that week. The following week after that, I think I totaled 5 experiences in 1 week. I haven't looked back. 5 years on, I don't have a political bone in my body. I'm not conspiracy orientated anymore. This kind of stuff has just dropped by the wayside because it's just not important to me anymore. I've come to realize that there, you know, is this truer nature of reality. And we're arguing over all these semantics, all religions, you know, society, all these social rules. We're arguing over all these man-made constructs and ultimately just the semantics of this reality. So I wanted to take the journey a little bit further. A year ago I started teaching the subject, the out-of-body state, expanded states of awareness. I do that through lucid dreaming mainly to get people started. Dreaming is something that we all share in common, so it's the baseline that we can all explore from without having to kind of hang up our belief systems. So I teach people how to recall their dreams first and foremost, because without recalling your dreams, you're not going to probably have a spontaneous lucid dream. A lucid dream where you induce it yourself unless it is spontaneous. So first teach people how to recall their dreams. Get to a point where people are recalling 3 or 4 dreams a night. So I've taught people that are easily accessing 10 plus dreams every single night. People think, well, that sounds impossible. Not at all impossible. once you learn some simple techniques, which I'm going to teach you later tonight at the end of the talk, you'll be able to do the same within a week to 2 weeks period of time. Once you're recalling that level of dream recall, you can then start using some lucid dreaming techniques, which I will also teach you tonight. And with that, you can become conscious within a dream. And what will be interesting is once you start becoming conscious within the dream state, and you come back into physical reality, how you might perceive this as being the dream state. Because the actual lucid dreaming state and the out-of-body state can be much more vivid than this, much more real than this. And it fools me all the time. I come back to my physical body, I have to make sure I'm not having a false awakening. Anybody seen Inception, the new film Inception? It's all about lucid dreaming. And false awakenings are where you've just finished dreaming. You are very conscious that you were dreaming. Finished dreaming, maybe you get up to go to the toilet, and as you cross in the hallway, you see a picture on the wall. Ooh, I don't remember having a picture like that on my wall. And it hits you, you're still in the dream state. So you wake yourself up, you get out of bed, you start walking to the loo, and maybe the picture that should be there is there. You get to the toilet, you try to flick the light switch, and your hand goes right through it. Once again, you're still in this dream state, a false awakening. I think my maximum to date is 4 false awakenings. I know people who have had 10 plus false awakenings, and it just gets to a point where you think, am I going to wake up? So it can be very frightening stuff. Tonight, we're going to, this talk is going to get pretty deep. And again, the door is locked, but I'm sure you really need to leave. That's fine. With the questions, I'm quite happy to accept questions throughout the talk. Especially if it's you just need a little bit of clarification on what I'm talking about at that moment. Otherwise, if it's just something that's come up, which is related to to this multidimensional universe in general, if you could just maybe write that down and save it for questions and answers later. But I am quite happy to accept questions throughout the talk. So this talk will empower you with knowledge and tools that you'll need to kind of go deeper yourselves to access your own truth, whether it's personal truth or universal truth. And it'll help you profoundly transform your understanding of yourself, the human experience, and the universe. Like I said, 5 years ago, I was very political, very conspiracy orientated. These things just don't show up on my radar anymore. I see them as being the semantics of the design of the system, something I don't need to get worked up about anymore. Also, discover the true purpose of your life and why you chose to incarnate in physical reality at this moment in time. It was a year ago, I was really kind of pushing the boundaries on trusting intuition. And I had this vision come through of me wearing this A4 sheet of paper on my chest with a little sign that read, free seminar on consciousness. And I thought, higher self, you're having a laugh. I could see myself standing in my local town center with like 100,000 people walking, doing their shopping, and me standing there like some sort of pillar with this sign on my front and back. And I thought, no way, higher self, I'm not going to do that. I thought that was maybe some sort of ego thing, so I let it go. And it kept presenting itself again and again and again. And through 3 years of hitchhiking, I have learned to not just trust these instincts, but act on these instincts. So it got to the point where I just couldn't ignore the signals any further. So I got on the computer and I printed off these 2 sheets of paper. I got out some sticky tape and I stuck it onto myself. And I got a clipboard and I walked into my local town center, standing there like a comic. And within minutes, people were walking by and snickering and laughing at me. And I thought to myself, no, dig deep. I'm not here for them. It's not about them. It's not their time to wake up. You know, there are people that are going to walk by today. They're going to maybe walk up to me and share a synchronicity as to why they're standing here in front of me, how they should be home by now, or how they should have went that way when they were compelled to go this way. And by the end of the weekend, I had 24 stories almost just like that. And a week later, all 24 people showed up at my house. And we had an amazing evening together of learning and sharing. And so I took that and I thought, okay, great. That, for me, I was just sort of getting my footing, wondering if I had anything to say that people would actually be interested in hearing. So I explored that a little bit more. And within a couple of months, people were coming back and they were kind of, you know, calling me up and texting me and wanting to go deeper down this rabbit hole of consciousness. And I then started doing seminars. I started doing talks. I've done a couple big talks in London. And I now do workshops on a regular basis. The big workshop I run is a weekend workshop, and it's all about out-of-body exploration. Take people very, very deep over that weekend. We actually have practice sessions throughout the night, and it's held in this phenomenal venue down in London. It's called the London Water Tower. It's a converted Victorian water tower that stands 130 foot just near the river by the Thames, looking out over London. It's got its own moat, its own private walled garden, and for 2 days it's an absolute fortress for people who want to come and feel supported to kind of go deeper down this rabbit hole of consciousness. On the weekend just passed, I ran a workshop where 15 people attended for the overnight stuff. Out of 15 people, 7 people experienced a conscious out-of-body experience. Others have now since gone home and used the techniques and been very motivated, and they too have now experienced OBEs. There's just a few that have still not from that group experienced an OBE. So it's a very powerful weekend, and it's something that I just feel so motivated and inspired to share with people, because to help people access this deep nature of who and what you really are, you know, to actually put your finger on it. We all have pieces of the puzzle. We all have the whole truth inside of us. You know, this is a holographic nature to this universe, and we are one aspect of that universe. Like a real hologram, you know, if you take one little piece and you break a piece off of that hologram, it will retain the copy of all the data on that original hologram. The only difference is it will be slightly fuzzy. The data will be slightly fuzzy, and that's just like us. Our higher self sits here in the soul plane during this journey. And here we are, one aspect of our soul, shrouded in human amnesia, to experience this autonomous journey that we need to, in order to help the soul learn about itself, and therefore the soul, which is a constituent asset of the universe, to help the universe learn about itself. So, what I'd like to start with is the true nature of the soul. Years ago, when I was a child, I was brought up in a Southern Baptist church in Florida. And from a very young age, I was practically forced to go to Sunday school. And every week, week in and week out, I would have this man stand up on this pulpit and shout at me and everybody else in the congregation, and it just didn't feel right. I can't tell you how many times I was told that I was going to hell if I did this, this, or this. And I just thought, wow, that's so vicious. I can't imagine wanting to kind of die someday and actually go to this place called heaven and meet this God that wants us to be so fearful. It just didn't feel right. And I was kind of deeply conditioned to believe that the soul was contained here within this physical vessel. When I had my first out-of-body experience, what I experienced, as far as I'm concerned, what I was concerned with at that time, was not my soul. I could feel that I was conscious within that moment, but I felt that what I was accessing was just another vehicle, if you like, a non-physical body, which was an aspect of my soul, perhaps, or a projection of my soul. And what out-of-body explorers such as Robert Monroe, William Buhlman, myself, and many other highly experienced explorers have now come to realize is that the soul itself is here during this entire human journey. Its vibrational energy is so refined, it can't actually come here into the physical plane. So what it actually does is it projects its awareness from this soul plane, which is beyond time and space. So the soul sits in a place of eternity, experiences everything simultaneously. So the soul will then project its consciousness, its awareness, down to these non-physical fields of reality to animate a physical body on Earth. So ultimately, we are just a projection of our soul, one aspect of the soul's overall consciousness. Now, before I go any further, there's two things I need to say. One is, I'm not here to convince you of anything. Nothing at all. So even if the things that I say tonight deeply resonate with you, please use the tools that I share with you later to find out the truth for yourself. I'm not here to convert you. This isn't business as usual where I need to convert you or need to make you think the way I think. It's not about that. All I'm here to do tonight is share ideas with you to stimulate your mind, perhaps in ways that you've never been stimulated before. That's my only purpose tonight. I don't need to convince you of anything. Next, this model of reality that you see in front of you, this is created for your linear brain. This model of reality, the multidimensional universe, all these non-physical planes and the physical plane, none of these fields of reality are separated spatially. They're all right here, right now. The only thing that separates us from the physical plane, from the first dimension, the astral planes, the higher planes of consciousness, and the soul plane, is vibration, wavelengths. That's it. There's no up or down, there's no left or right. This is all physical reality kind of constructs. The multidimensional universe is separated by wavelengths, vibrations. The more refined your vibrational energy, the more you head towards the soul plane in your experiences. The further you go inwards with this vibrational journey, the less time and space have any sort of bearing. Like I said at the start, the soul plane sits beyond time and space, and the soul experiences all of these realities simultaneously. And that has quite an interesting sort of bearing, and we'll talk about that in the past, present, future in regards to things such as reincarnation, which is very important, also in respect to karma. Because I think in the West, and in some traditions in the East, we have this kind of sense that karma is this kind of punitive system of punishment. How many times have you perhaps heard in your own spiritual circles people say things like, what goes around comes around? You know what, when I hear people say in my spiritual circles, what goes around comes around, I see that as being highly aligned with the religious scaremongering that I experienced when I was a child. I don't see the universe as being so unfriendly. I don't see that with our own free will, we co-create this reality and then get punished for it. To me, that's not what I experience in the out-of-body state as being karma. I think the universe is much more creative than that. We are much more creative than that. So, after a few of my out-of-body experiences, and I started going deeper into this multidimensional universe, what I started to realize was that, yes, my soul is not contained within this physical body. I can understand how, in a near-death experience, where someone is floating above their physical body during an operation that's gone wrong, seeing an accident, they're technically dead, they're hovering above their physical body, maybe they have one of these tunnels of light that they report open up, and maybe they feel this presence coming through the tunnel. These tunnels of light, I find, are not exclusive to near-death experiences, and they're not exclusive to taking you to some place like heaven. These are energy corridors, they're portals, they're vortexes that open up between these different fields of reality, and allow explorers, travelers, to go through to higher vibrational planes. So what I came to find out and discover, same as some other out-of-body explorers, is yes, the soul sits here, parks itself here during this human journey, and focuses its awareness down through these physical, non-physical fields and the physical field, animates the physical body. So we have this continuum of consciousness that emanates from the soul plane to here. So ultimately, we are the end product of thought. We are the dream. So I started taking this a little bit deeper and started thinking about, well, how does this apply to things such as reincarnation? Because with what I seem to be discovering, what other out-of-body explorers are discovering, is that if the soul is timeless, it sits in this place of eternity, it sits in this place beyond time and space and experiences everything simultaneously, how does that impact our belief systems in respect to karma and reincarnation? Because with karma, the predominant belief systems with karma, we see it as this kind of linear cause and effect system. Whatever I do in one lifetime, I'm going to be affected by that in the next lifetime. Let's look at this in a more dynamic way. So here's the soul animating one physical body with its consciousness, one aspect of its overall consciousness, you. Right now, are one aspect of your soul. Do you think the soul's only powerful enough to animate one physical body, to have one incarnation at a time? So here we go, we have a soul. Multiple incarnations taking place across the whole spectrum of the human experience, being the poorest of the poor, the richest of the rich, everything in between, experiencing what we perceive as a linear past, present, future. So, here we are in the present, and we think about our past life experiences. And we think of that as in, ooh, all of those experiences are me. But ultimately, if the soul experiences everything simultaneously, then in some sense, yes, some of these life experiences that you might tap into will be experiences related to your aspect of consciousness, that one aspect of the soul. But the rest of them are individual aspects of your soul, autonomous beings in their own rights, given powers to co-create on this physical plane. So the soul itself is growing exponentially through this simultaneous experience. Why do we have things like deja vus? Why do we have precognitive dreams? We have these because ultimately all of these other aspects of you, of your soul, these other incarnations are taking place simultaneously alongside your current existence. And what you're doing when you have something like a precognition or a deja vu, you're accessing what people label the Akashic Records. I think there's a lot of mysticism shrouding what the Akashic Records are. People kind of see it as being this library, this non-physical library where all data is stored. To me, there's no mysticism about it. I see the soul plane, and I see the Akashic Records being one of the same. I see the Akashic Records as being the combined consciousness of all the souls. It's nothing more mystical than that. It is the combined consciousness of all the souls. Everything that has happened, is happening, or will happen. I then look at, like I said, about karma. How does karma fit into the system? If not all of these aspects are me repeating through reincarnation, cycling back into the system, how can I be punished for an aspect of my overall consciousness which is not actually related to me, as in my own direct experiences? Or, once again, with my own free will, me choosing to co-create with other souls, how can I be punished for that? How can we co-create this reality and then be punished through some sort of punitive system? It just didn't make any sort of sense to me. So digging deeper and deeper, I start to find that we choose our own, with our own free will from the soul plane, before that one aspect of consciousness incarnates into this physical body. It chooses its fate. It chooses its destiny. People say to me, aren't fate and destiny the same thing? No. I know the words seem to be interchangeable, but they're not the same thing. Okay, so what is fate and destiny? Fate is this physical body. You chose this physical body. You chose this DNA. Fate is your family. You chose to be born into the family you've been born into. Fate is your social economic circumstances you were born into. Fate is your time of birth. Fate is that fated moment when you'll die. Fate is your relationships. Fate is most of the experiences that you're ever going to have. People might think, well, no, I've got it all wrong. I was destined to write this book. As far as I can see now, with all of these experiences and the combined kind of knowledge of these other out-of-body explorers, writing that book, meeting certain people, having certain relationships, that's fate. So what is destiny? If what I always assumed was destiny, I was destined to meet this person, I was destined to do this. No, we're fated to meet that person, we're fated to have that experience. What is destiny? You've just taken that away from me. What is destiny? Destiny is the quality that you bring to each one of those experiences. Look at it in very simple terms. The expression, fate are the cards life deals you. Destiny is how you play those cards. That is the best way I can sum up fate and destiny. Look at it another way. Lemons and lemonade. Lemons are akin to the fate. How do we get the lemonade? That's the quality that we bring to the experience. How much of the lemon do we squeeze? How much sugar do we add? How much water to get the mixture, which is our quality that we bring to an experience? So ultimately, I see fate as being our relationships, our physical body that we choose, all the experiences that we're going to have. And within each one of those moments, it's up to us, with our own free will that we now have within the physical existence as well. We don't stop having free will on the soul plane when we choose our fate and our destiny and our karma and everything else that goes into these soul contracts. That transcends into the physical reality. Within the physical reality, we have the ability to use our free will to keep ourselves off of our life path, to keep ourselves away from our purpose. We have that right, this universal right, to use our own free will. And we all do it all the time. So I kind of look at karma in a different light, I think, than most people. I kind of look at reincarnation in a different light than most people. And I don't see the universe as being this unfriendly behemoth, which is all about punishment. I see it as being much more dynamic, much more creative, much more friendly. I see that if we are truly creating this reality from the soul plane, then we're doing it with the purpose of growth, to learn more about who and what we really are. I don't see the souls and on the soul plane as being about labels like we are here in physical reality. We label everything, good, bad, evil, and everything else in between. If the universe was to label something as being bad, and therefore it might say, ooh, we've got to put a stop to that, it's just limited itself. It's limited its infinite expression. How can you have infinite expression if you take these labels and you say, we can't do that because that's bad, or that's a bad person? If we co-create this reality, then ultimately we're about having experiences. The soul is about having experience. The ego is about labeling things, good and bad. So I don't see karma in that sort of punitive system of punishment anymore. I think we are much more dynamic than that, far, far more creative for that sort of system. If we take karma a little bit deeper, let's say with this soul contract, with my fate, I choose within one lifetime to be a millionaire. So if I'm a millionaire within one lifetime, there's different flavors of being a millionaire. I could be a real miser with my money and not share shared wealth. I could come back again as a millionaire and be a philanthropist and be very giving with my money. But at some point, you're probably going to be repeating patterns. So if you've been a philanthropist millionaire within one lifetime, then your karma going into this next lifetime will probably prevent you from being a millionaire philanthropist again, because the soul's covered that base. It doesn't need to walk down that road again. It has that knowledge. So I see karma as something that we set for ourselves within this lifetime. These are my primary experiences, my primary life experiences. That's karma. These are my secondary life experiences. Again, karma. We create that ourselves. It only makes sense that if I'm going to be a millionaire, I will have to eventually experience the flip side of that. If I'm going to know what it is to be human, I have to be the richest of the rich, the poorest of the poor, and everything in between. But I don't have to punish myself. It's not a matter of punishment. It's a matter about experience. I've been rich. How do I know what it is to be poor unless I have that experience? So once again, I see karma as being much more dynamic than the limited system of linear cause and effect that a lot of people kind of look at it. Once again, I'm not here to convince you of this. This is for you to decide. By the end of this night, you will have the tools to go deeper yourselves, to explore beyond this physical reality, to access your own soul contract, if you will, to hold counsel with aspects of your own higher self. On a regular basis now, when I get out of body, I have guides come to me that I know are not autonomous beings, as in separate souls or separate entities. I know they're an aspect of my soul. What better guide for you than an aspect of yourself? An aspect of you that sits here in the soul plane in this holding pattern while you have this physical incarnation, this physical journey within the Earth Life system. An aspect of you which is you. You'll never leave yourself. How could you? You have unconditional patience for yourself, unconditional love for yourself. One aspect of yourself here in the physical journey, bigger part of who and what you really are, patiently sits on the edge of your reality, waiting for you to expand this conduit, this continuum of consciousness. The more you expand and open up this continuum of consciousness and access this, the more you strengthen your connection between this physical self and the higher aspect of your being. And I think when you access the highest aspect of your being, and you trust this very authentic voice, and then you act it, you have the courage to act, you open up that conduit even more. And I think talking about destiny, to me, our ultimate destiny, beyond just being a service-oriented role, which to me it makes a lot of sense, is to be higher self in the flesh. To get to a point where that conduit is so wide open, you bring that deep knowledge of the soul here into the flesh. What is being higher self in the flesh? To me, that's something like Jesus. Let's not argue about whether he was a real man. Just looking at the stories are beautiful. Take the story of Jesus in the market square. washing the feet of lepers. Washing the feet of lepers. Whose feet is he actually washing? Anybody? He's washing his own feet. Higher self in the flesh doesn't see duality. Higher self in the flesh doesn't experience separation. Higher self sees itself. It doesn't see lepers. To me, that is the ultimate destiny of all of us, is to have that incarnation where we allow ourselves to be higher self in the flesh, to bring that deep knowledge here, to be in service, unconditionally in service to each other. Is it time for that break now?
Let me say so.
Okay, so what we'll do is we'll restart it. Please could we welcome Todd back?
So Debra, what time do you want me to take this up to now?
If we go up to, say, 25 past 9, and then that's including questions and answers, yeah.
Okay, so we've got a lot to cover during this 55 minutes then. I'd like to go into depth on what you can experience in these other planes of reality, what type of humans and other sort of entities you'll find there. I'd then like to obviously share some techniques with you on how you can recall your dreams on a regular basis, then be able to become lucid within the dream state, to then be able to change the dream that you're within to maybe something much more productive for you as an individual, and then to give you maybe one simple little out-of-body technique that can help you go much deeper down this rabbit hole. And then of course we'll take some questions. Once again, I'm happy to take questions throughout, but if we can keep it relevant, and then we can maybe make more general questions towards the end. Okay, so what did I start experiencing in this first dimension outside of the physical reality? First and foremost, this first dimension outside of physical reality, this first non-physical plane, is an exact energy duplicate of physical reality. This is where a lot of people, when they have their first spontaneous OBE, or self-initiated OBE, they will find themselves there in the first dimension outside of physical reality, usually hovering around their physical body. Maybe they feel like they're floating up in the air. They walk through the wall of their house. They're in that first non-physical dimension outside of physical reality. This, again, is a complete energy copy of physical reality. It overlays all of physical reality, and you actually experience it in real time. So if you were to pop out of your physical body right now and look back into this room, you would actually see everything taking place in real time. You may experience the odd reality fluctuation. Maybe there'll be a picture on this wall, which isn't there in physical reality. And there's a good reason for that. This first non-physical plane is actually the original copy. If anyone understands the energy principles and mechanics of manifestation, then you always have to have the creation before you have the manifestation. So once again, if all thought originates from the soul plane, from your own spiritual source, when it impacts on these non-physical realities, which are very, very thought responsive, in non-physical reality, when you have a thought, that thought equals an action. So whatever you think about will instantly mold and shape non-physical reality. So,
is that because of visualization part?
It has nothing to do with seeing whatsoever. It's basically because of the thought-responsive nature of reality. As soon as you have a thought, you impact that non-physical reality, and you start to mold those very, in some cases, if the energy is in its raw state, it will mold very quickly. If it's in what's called a consensus environment, then you can't change anything within those consensus environments. We'll get to a consensus environment when we touch on the astral planes. Consensus environments are things such as Christian heaven, Christian hell. All these places and all the equivalents for all the other religions, they do exist. But like I alluded to earlier, they're just extensions of this illusion. So this model of reality validates all religious belief systems. The difference is, it goes beyond and goes to the deeper nature of who and what we are. We are not these limited beings that are being locked into a kind of a Christian heaven belief system for all of eternity. That is just one consensus reality being held together by the consensus thoughts, the combined thoughts of all the inhabitants within that space. So the soul, so you have a thought in your physical reality. your thoughts then impact non-physical reality and starts to create. Let's take something, an example such as Santa Claus, this jolly fat man. So every year we have millions of children worldwide focused on Santa Claus. Why does that not manifest in the physical reality? We do get part of the manifestation. We get the holiday cheer. We get the gift giving. That's an aspect of the manifestation. But why don't we get this, you know, fat, you know, bearded, red clothed clad individual with flying reindeer kind of shooting across the sky? This is probably due to the higher will, the collective. Does it serve humanity? What purpose would it serve to have this Santa Claus floating around in physical reality? There is a Lapland in the astral planes. There are elves busy making toys. All of this combined thought molds and shapes this non-physical reality. This is now a consensus environment, like unicorns, the tooth fairy. Anything and everything that you might think of as being legend or myth exists here in the astral planes. It's a phenomenal place. It's one of the biggest non-physical fields between the physical and the soul plane. This is where we have all the afterlife belief systems. You, believe it or not, have your own place on the astral plane. Each and every one of us unconsciously goes out of our bodies every single night. But there is an aspect of you which is conscious from those deeper levels within those experiences. The difference is you just don't remember. You fall back into this human amnesia. And there is a reason for that. But once you start consciously exploring your true nature, this deeper nature of reality, and you can start remembering, it becomes that much more beneficial. Your growth can become exponential. But getting back to the first dimension outside of physical reality, who and what can you find in this first dimension? This is where we have this ghost application. People talk about ghosts, mediums, psychics, interacting with the ghost of a departed loved one or an entity that's trapped within a certain field. This is what they're talking about. This is also what religion talks about, such as the limbo state, purgatory. It does exist. That is the first dimension outside of physical reality. There are a lot of pissed off, angry, confused, non-physical humans who do not know what to do next. That is purgatory. If you can imagine, if you don't have an afterlife belief system, a strong afterlife belief system that's going to lead you into one of these higher astral planes, you can get locked into this first dimension outside of physical reality for a long period of time. There's another veil of illusion that gets in place, that gets sat in place between you and these higher vibrational fields of reality. Even if you have a strong afterlife belief system, if your vibration, your inner vibrational frequency, is only set for this vibrational field of reality, you're going no further. Why is that? It's probably because it's part of your soul contract. You're not stuck there. Your soul's not, kind of lost track of one of its aspects. It knows exactly where you are. It's not calling you home. It's not bringing you back to the fold because it has your back. You instructed this greater aspect of yourself before coming into this physical body. These are my major life patterns. These are my lessons. These are the things I've come here to learn. Have my back. Don't make it easy for me to just come back to the fold and be, have this this reunification with self, with the highest aspect. I've got things to learn and experience on these other dimensional fields. Just because we physically die doesn't mean we stop being human. All of this, between the physical and the soul plane, is the Earth life system, the human experience. There is more non-physical humanity in the astral planes than there are in physical reality. So, in the first dimension outside of physical reality, we have what we call ghosts. It's a very derogatory term, but that's how most people label them. They're non-physical humans. They no longer have a physical body, so they're discarnate. But they're still acting within this continuum of consciousness, this one aspect of who they are during this human journey. So here they are in the first dimension outside of physical reality. Some of them that I've encountered don't even realize that they're dead. You might think, well, how can you not realize you're dead? It's very easy not to realize you're dead. Let's say you're walking across the street with your iPod blaring away, and you're focused, in the distance, and suddenly, smack, a bus hits you, your physical body goes that way, you keep walking. It happens a lot. People die on their deathbeds, don't even realize they're dead. They stay in a hospital bed for years and years and years. People totally ignoring them, doctors, interns, everybody ignoring them. They don't understand why. Can you imagine getting hit by this bus, not realizing your physical body, is mangled lying on the street, and you walk over to Tesco, you go inside, you try to pick up a plum in the produce department, and your hand goes right through it. You're not going to suddenly think you're dead. You're just going to think there's something wrong with the plum or your hand. So you try to pick something else up, and you think, oh, no, definitely the produce. So you go up to the produce manager, hey, buddy, something wrong with your fruit. And then he ignores you. Are you going to think you're dead? Or are you going to think this guy's got a problem? So maybe you take it further. Before you know it, you're getting really angry and pissed off with people because everybody's ignoring you. But you don't realize you're dead. You weren't aware of that transition, that little click that takes place. It's instantaneous for a lot of people. So here you are in the first dimension out of physical reality. All you're aware of is physical reality that's going on around you. That's all you're aware of. Maybe eventually it clicks, I must be dead. What do I do next? If that's, again, once again, your vibrational energy is set for that field of reality, you're going nowhere until that vibrational energy shifts. And it's probably going to only shift through the experiences that you're going to have. I had a poltergeist take place in my house a couple years ago. I was practicing my out-of-body techniques about 4 o'clock in the morning, sitting in my lounge in my reclining chair, which is one of my favorite places to do my out-of-body practices. I had vibrations roar through me, and suddenly I could feel myself, you know, having that lifting away from the physical body. Suddenly, there were three non-physical humans sat down in front of my chair. As soon as I had that non-physical sight, and I could see into my non-physical lounge, I could see those three non-physical humans. They're completely ignoring me, just kind of communicating amongst themselves. And I was a little bit shocked by it, so I thought, ooh, I'm not quite ready for this. I think I'm going to go back in my physical body. So I kind of darted back in, and the vibrations started to fade, but I was in full paralysis. Couldn't move, couldn't even use my vocal cords. So the vibrations roared back through, and I was like, oh, must be joking. And kind of slightly catapulted away from the physical body. The three non-physical humans were still there. And a fourth one walked through the bay window of my house. And I was thinking, oh, okay, I'm not ready at all. So once again, tried to disengage from it. Disengaged, was back into the physical body. The vibrations I could still feel there. I could feel full paralysis. And once again, the vibrations roared back through. And oh, I already go again. Out, three humans there, the one that walked through, and a fifth one walked through the partition from the kitchen. And I just thought, this is just madness. 5 non-physical humans in my house, 5 ghosts in my house. What do they want? And eventually, between in and out, I lost consciousness. I woke up within my physical body at some point. For the next few days, those non-physical humans made their presence well known throughout the house, pushing objects around, getting my attention in many ways. And I didn't see it as being malicious. What I kind of discovered for myself is they were just curious. They could sense this human, this physical human, going in and out of the body at will. How and why can they not do it? They probably saw me on occasion come out of my physical body, stand in my lounge, or stand maybe out in my local area, and suddenly teleport completely out of view. I've teleported from that first dimension into a higher plane of reality. And they think, where'd he go? Why can't I do that? And they get angry, they get confused, they just don't know what's happening. So perhaps in a way they see me as being an opportunity to learn about what's taking place, how can they go where I go, what is happening, where am I going? And this is what some people relate to soul retrieval. You're not retrieving your soul, you're just retrieving an aspect of somebody else's soul. And I would kind of use a caveat that if you're able to retrieve that aspect, then it's probably part of their soul contract. If it's not part of their soul contract, then I don't think there's anything you can do about it, no matter how much you try, because you have no power over anybody else's soul. So, I've experienced many non-physical humans in the States. One time in an out-of-body experience, I was out hovering on a country lane in the middle of nowhere, and I came up to this stone wall that was sat overlooking this deep valley. And peripherally, I could see another human standing on the wall, and I looked over, and it was this young boy. Could have only been about 10 years old. And instantly, I knew he was dead, that he'd transitioned. And we started to communicate, and he wouldn't listen to anything I had to say. He was in a deep, deep state of denial. And eventually, he just completely ignored me, kind of floated off down this valley and into through this wall of this farmhouse. And I thought, with a little kind of smirk on my face, How can you not get it? How can you be in that deep a denial that a little boy doesn't realize he's just floated down a valley and floated through a wall of a house? I mean, that's pretty deep denial. So I floated down the valley, floated through the wall of the house, and I found him tucked into bed with this physical boy. And I tried to get him to see the difference between, you know, him and this other boy. And once again, he completely ignored me. So there was nothing more I could do about it. So I left him, went back to my physical body. A few weeks went by. Once again, I was up about 4 o'clock in the morning doing my practices, got out of the physical body, and I was there in my lounge. And suddenly I could sense that there was a non-physical human outside in the driveway and was coming towards the bay window. So I thought, oh no, some sort of animal instincts took over. And I shot through the bay window, and I just went, rah! Scared the bejesus out of this little boy. And he just shot off. And then it hit me when I got back to my physical body. It was the little boy that I met a couple weeks earlier. And he'd obviously come to terms with that, you know, out of all the non-physical humans he'd encountered, I was the only one that was willing to help unconditionally and didn't have, you know, something that I wanted in return. How did he find me? Just the same as you can find anybody. Whenever you get out of your physical body, if you want to find a loved one who's already passed on, no matter where they are in one of these fields of reality, even if they've cycled back into the Earth life system, back into the physical system through reincarnation, all you have to do is think about their essence. Think about the essence of that person, and you will suddenly feel a shift in motion, and you will either arrive to where they're at on the astral planes, where most of them will be, or like I said, if they've cycled back into the system, then you'll be hovering there in physical reality, looking back into this physical reality and their current existence. I've got a friend of mine who lives down in Worthing. He's had 40 years of out-of-body exploration. He's written a book called Multidimensional Man, which I highly recommend. He presents a model of reality that totally blows this one. He recently wanted to, he's 60 years old, and he wanted to find his father. And so he was expecting to find his father in the astral planes. And so he thought about his father and asked to be taken to his father. And he suddenly was drawn to the first dimension outside of physical reality, overlooking physical reality, a village in Russia, a small village in Russia. And he could see this 9-year-old boy playing on a bicycle in the front garden. And instantly he could feel the energy that was his father. And the brother, the older brother that was playing with him was his grandfather. So if you do start using these techniques and you want to meet up with loved ones, then it's entirely possible. One of my most profound experiences to date involved one of my own loved ones. When I was 12 years old, when I was 10 years old, my father died, and eventually my mother remarried when I was 12. I was a real kind of jerk of a kid to this stepfather. I really was. I was just about making his life hell. And I've since come to find that he was a really good man. It was just me being a real rebellious pain in the ass. And so there was all this really kind of bad mistrust and all this negative energy built up between us by the time I left home when I was 17. I came here when I was 23, and he died 2 months later, and we never had the opportunity to kind of, come to terms with that and be at peace with each other. 14 years onwards, and I started, was it 14? Yeah, I guess about 14 years later, when I started having these out-of-body experiences, I was in my lounge once again, in my reclining chair, and the vibrations swept through, and I could feel myself lifting away, and suddenly this massive vortex, this wormhole, tunnel of light, energy, you know, whatever you want to call it, they're all one and the same, opened up. I mean, it was massive, it was purple, and it was black, it was like a swirling black hole. And I went through it, and I was deposited somewhere here on the astral plane. So I could feel the energy was akin to the astral planes. I've been there enough times to know where I was. And as I came out the other side of this portal, this vortex, my stepfather was there. And I first thought, I was like, wow, what's he doing here? And he'd had 14 years in non-physical reality, in these non-physical planes. Very subjective time. 14 years to him could have seemed like a lifetime physically. So whenever you're out of body exploring, maybe you're only out of body for 10 minutes, that could seem like hours, and it does seem like hours because it's subjective reality, it's subjective time. I teach people in my workshops how to live more than a 24-hour day. Here you are, maybe you're living 16, 17 hours consciously within waking reality. Teach you how to become conscious within your dreams. Teach you how to have these fully conscious out-of-body experiences, which are subjective, time-wise. The further you go away from physical reality, the less bearing time has. Everything seems to slow down to where you get to the point where the soul plane, there is no time, there is no form, there is just pure consciousness. So here was my stepfather stood there, and he just moved towards me, and we had this telepathic exchange. In most cases, beyond the first dimension, it's very telepathic. That is the communication of choice with non-physical humans and these other beings that we come into contact with. It's telepathic. The closer you get to the soul plane, it becomes even more dynamic than telepathic. Can't even explain it. It is the most bizarre stuff. So we had this little telepathic exchange, and I could see all these pictures running through my head of my childhood and our time together. And then suddenly, he beamed this pure love energy into my heart center that flattened me. Absolutely flattened me. I've never felt anything like it in physical reality. Floored me. He then embraced me. And within what could have only been seconds, I could feel all of that mistrust, all that negativity was being incinerated by this love energy, this pure love energy. I'd never in my life experienced anything like it. I have three children. Those of you who have children, you know the love that you have for children. It is a deep, deep love. It blew it out of the water. It made it pale into insignificance. When we finally moved away from each other, he gave me this little wink, and he teleported out of there. I came back to my physical body, and I laid there for a long, long time just crying, just letting that release, that sort of healing take place fully. And when I realized at that moment in my life, is that we are powerful beyond what we give ourselves credit. We don't need a whole lifetime of going to see a psychologist. We can heal ourselves on all levels of our being instantaneously if we want to. We are unlimited at our very nature. The core of who and what we really are, we have an unlimited potential. Through physical reality, through conditioning and programming, we have learned to be limited. We are limited meat suits with an unlimited potential. You're beautiful. You're perfect. It's time for you to rediscover that. None of you are here by accident. People that come to my workshops, come to my talks, you're not here by accident. You have a higher self like I have. You have a soul like I have. Through synchronicity, one way or another, you decided to come here tonight. I'm going to share some techniques with you now, and then we'll go through the questions and answers. First and foremost, dreaming. To recall your dreams on a regular basis, not just one dream, not just two, more than five. First thing I'd like you to do is to keep a dream journal. Whenever you spontaneously wake up in the night, all you need to do is pick up the pen, paper, and pen, and just jot down just the highlights of the dream, just little bullet points. That's all you need to. Maybe the dream characters, the predominant dream characters, the theme, how did it make you feel? Then put your pen and paper down and go back to sleep. Whenever you spontaneously wake, just record your dream or any fragments of the dream into the journal. Beyond a journal, which is perhaps one of the top things I can possibly recommend, if you want to go a little bit further, have a series of alarms to wake you up at ideal moments throughout the night. Set your first alarm at 4.5 hours. Actually, that's a bit hardcore. Set it for 6 hours. So 6 hours after you go to sleep, set yourself your first alarm. This is going to wake you up into one of your first long REM cycles. You've already had 4 hours of delta restorative sleep, which will help rejuvenate the mind and the body. After an extra 2 hours on top of that 4 hour delta sleep, you're coming into predominant REM cycle periods. The mind is actually, it's been proven in dream lab studies that the mind is actually as active, and if not more active, within REM periods than you are in waking reality. So you're not going to be doing yourself any harm by waking up at these periods, recording your dreams, and going back to sleep. So, 6 hour mark, you have your first alarm go off. As soon as the alarm goes off, switch it off, and then lie completely still. If you've moved position, move straight back into the position that you woke up from. This will help you connect with the dream that you've just had. At that point, your dreams are about, your REM cycles are about 20 minutes in length. It can be even longer. When you hit the 7.5 hour mark, once you've recorded your dream, reset your alarm for another hour and a half. This will take you up to a 7.5 hour mark. At that point, your REM periods are about 45 minutes in duration to an hour. So you're dreaming for a whole 45 minutes to an hour. A lot of people assume we dream for seconds and minutes only and it's over with. No, dream lab studies have well and truly kind of shown that we dream for longer cycles than that. So within that 45 minutes to an hour, you could actually have 5, 6, 10 different dreams. So to wake yourself up within one of these REM cycles, you have an opportunity to recall several dreams in one go. And then at that point, hopefully you'll just be in and out of light sleep for the rest of the morning until you wake up. Now, some of you might be thinking, okay, that sounds like a lot of sleep. I don't currently get that much sleep. I would highly recommend that if you're not getting more than 6 hours of sleep, do your best to do so. Even if that means, looking at your life and say to yourself, how can I, restructure this a little bit? What distractions are stopping me from exploring, this deeper nature of reality? Television. Are you currently watching television? I don't watch TV anymore. I find that there's nothing Hollywood produce. The combined assets of Hollywood cannot give me the access to what I can in these non-physical fields of reality. The things that I've come across, man, mind-blowing stuff. So it's worth the journey. What can I set aside for maybe the next month, the next 2 months? What kind of self-generated distraction can I just put to the side? So, keep a journal. Every single morning, record something in your journal, especially for the first few days, even if it's just, I don't recall anything, but I feel very positive. Write that down. And then in the evening time, as you get into bed, read through your journal, because this sets a very powerful intention. I intend to have more dreams, and to be able to recall more dreams, and to be able to journal more dreams. It's a very, very powerful device to use this journal. The alarm systems, for those of you who want to experiment with that, once again, first alarm 6 hours after you go to sleep, switch off the alarm, journal any sort of, I'd have a journal and a notebook. In the night, you pick up your notebook, and you just record just the basics of the dream. In the morning time, with those basics, those bullet points, you'll be able to flesh the dream out even more. You then transfer that into your journal, and put the date, the dream, how it made you feel, and then put it aside. Another way to help with the dream call is to share your dreams with other people on a regular basis. This has a twofold benefit. One, it helps you recall more concepts of the dream. So if you're sitting at the breakfast table with your partner and you're telling about your dream and you go, and this happened. So it helps you flesh out more content. But more importantly, it helps keep you accountable. Maybe a week goes by without sharing a dream with your partner and they suddenly say, "Ooh, why have you stopped telling me about your dreams? They're so interesting. I love hearing about them over breakfast." I think, yes, I haven't for a week now done any sort of recording my journal, and my recall has fallen off a little bit. So it helps keep you accountable. So sharing your dreams with as many people as you'd like. Another excellent technique is as if when you're going to sleep, say to yourself again and again, "Tonight I will remember my dreams. Tonight I will remember my dreams." You're programming yourself. So instead of letting society continue to program you, program yourself. "Tonight I will remember my dreams. I enjoy remembering my dreams. I enjoy remembering my dreams." So these are some of the recall techniques. Very basic, but very, very effective. After 2 weeks, you should be recalling. If you're not currently, who's not recalling a dream, at least one dream every morning? Okay, so about a third of the room. You practice these simple dream recall techniques, and within less than 2 weeks, you'll be recalling 3, 4, or 5 dreams a night. If you don't want to interrupt your sleep pattern too much, I'd suggest a voice recorder instead of a notepad. Most mobile phones have voice recorders built into them now, but there's a little bit of a problem with using these voice recorders. One morning I woke up, and I knew that I'd recorded at least 3 dreams, so I replayed it. And there was actually 5 dreams on there. So there was 2 dreams I wasn't even conscious of. And those other 2 dreams, I was kind of like listening to it as a, I had to re-listen to it like, you know, 5 times to get anything out of it. So you're that, you know, not very coherent, because you're literally just picking it up, blah, 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 putting it down. Whereas with the notepad, you're going to have a little bit more lucidity about what you're writing down and recording. So they do have their kind of their drawbacks. Okay, so here we are. We're now becoming, we're recalling dreams on a regular basis. How can we now become lucid, conscious within a dream? How can we wake up within a dream? One of the best ways is your hands. Most lucid dreamers are taught that do things called state testing. You're testing your reality. Maybe they'll teach you to make a wall change color or disappear entirely. This isn't going to work very well long term, especially if you start employing the out-of-body techniques. Because what I'd like to suggest to you right now is that the dream state, which science will have us believe is a construct of the mind, is something much more than that. Unconsciously, every single morning, every single night, we all go out of our bodies. We have unconscious OBEs. What is a dream? I've now come to realize that what a dream actually is you unconsciously leaving your body. At some point, you get to the astral plane on your journey, and your subconscious thoughts impact non-physical reality and creates what's called a thought form. Your thought form is your dream environment. It's a fantasy overlay. Just beyond your fantasy overlay is the astral plane proper. But you don't know that because you're wrapped up in your own little fantasy. If somebody was to walk by you while you were having a dream, while you're standing on the astral planes, they would see you standing still. They wouldn't see what you see because it's your own personal thought form, your own fantasy overlay. If you don't believe me, once again, I'm not here to convince you. I'm just here to stimulate your mind. That's it. Take the tools, find out the truth for yourself. The way I see it, dreams are not here in the mind, in the brain, you know, in that mental construct. It's something much more dynamic than that. You might find sometimes while you're within a lucid dream, the dream characters have a high level of autonomy. Maybe you ask them to do something and they say, get stuck. How can my own subconscious tell me to get stuffed? It may not be, a fantasy of your own making. It could actually be that you're on the astral plane, you're in a consensus environment, and you're actually communicating with a real, non-physical being. But you think it's part of your own dream. This is why it's important within lucid dreaming not to depend on things such as changing the colors of walls, or asking them to disappear. The only thing you can depend on is yourself. So, if you're out of body, or if you're within a dream, what you do to kind of become more aware, and I'll give you ways to help you do this, but simply, if you become aware, even slightly aware within a dream, you look at your hand and you make a very simple just ask yourself, am I dreaming or awake right now? And then you ask your hand to disappear. If you're in non-physical reality, your hand will disappear every single time. If you use a wall as your state testing, your reality testing, and you ask it to disappear, it might disappear, but it might ignore you. Because if you're in the first dimension outside of physical reality, which is that original copy, that's the creation, this is the manifestation. Physical Earth is the manifestation. This is the original copy, the creation. Therefore, nothing in that first dimension outside of physical reality will obey your commands. If you ask your toaster to disappear, it will ignore you. And rightfully so. On the astral plane, if you're in an astral copy of your house and you ask the toaster to disappear, it will disappear. If you're in the astral planes and you're in what's called a consensus environment, Christian heaven, let's say you stumble upon Christian heaven, and as you sweep through, you see the pearly gates and you ask, pearly gates, disappear now. The pearly gates will ignore you because you have billions and billions of non-physical humanity which are supporting that illusion. Just like 6 to almost 7 billion of physical humans support this illusion. We subscribe to this physical illusion. This is why it gets maintained. It's a powerful illusion, a very, very powerful illusion. I once found myself here on the astral plane not too many months back. I had this vortex once again open up after I got out of body, delivered me somewhere on the astral plane, and I was there at this recreation of an English village. I knew in my mind how it got there. Somebody kicked the bucket. Vibrationally, they found themselves on the astral plane, and they found themselves in a very raw energy state, so a non-consensus environment. The only thing they probably knew up to that point was their previous life on Earth, so they probably thought about home. Boom, suddenly their home, their house gets recreated. The blueprint from the Akashic Records instantly gets created. Oh, how'd that happen? Oh, I don't know. They suddenly think of the pub, post office. Before you know it, they've recreated their village. And maybe some other non-physical humans who have kind of crossed, transcended death, and they're strolling along the astral planes. Maybe heaven didn't appeal to them, and they come across this English village, and they stop into the local pub. And before you know it, this becomes a consensus environment. The more people that inhabit these spaces, the stronger that illusion becomes. So here I found myself in this English village on the astral plane, and I walked into this pub with all the local inhabitants. And I started doing what I'm doing now, just talking my truth. And suddenly I noticed people starting to get kind of angry and confused because I was asking them about their previous lives on Earth. What were they, people were saying, we are on Earth. What are you talking about? This is physical Earth. You're crazy. I said, no, this isn't physical Earth. This is what's called the astral plane. I'm from physical Earth. I'm still incarnate on the physical plane. And you're now here, disincarnate, on the astral planes. Blank faces. Everywhere blank faces. And then it started to occur to me. Think about when you wake up from a dream. It only takes 4 minutes before that dream starts to fade if you've not impressed that on your memory. Maybe you get up, you get distracted, you go to the toilet. No matter how vivid the dream was, within minutes, it's faded. Same thing happens with people when they get to the astral planes. Their focus is here. They completely lose track of their previous life on Earth. They fall into a new type of amnesia. It's powerful. The amnesia is as powerful there as it is here. Got to a point where I thought, I need to get out of here before I get stoned. So I started to make my exit, and this woman came straight up to me and she said, wait, I've always suspected. I always had the feeling that something wasn't quite right. And then it hit me. It wasn't me that activated that portal. It wasn't me that activated that tunnel of light, that vortex that brought me to that point on the astral plane. That was her higher self, working with my higher self. And me acting as a retrieval, as a retriever. It was her time to wake up from that illusion. It was her moment to go higher in her development. Make no mistake about it. Are you really arrogant enough to sit here in your chairs right now and think that you're on physical Earth? And that I'm not actually visiting you from physical Earth and teaching you somewhere in the astral planes right now? The illusions are strong. They're meant to be. This is how we learn. All knowledge of this Earth life system, past, present, future, is contained here. We know that on our deepest level of who and what we are. But to come here to have a new experience, to truly be autonomous, we have to be shrouded in this human amnesia. But once again, you're here tonight. You already know this, but I'm just reaffirming what you already know. And now I'm giving you tools to go even deeper. Obviously, higher self wants you to start poking your head down that rabbit hole much, much deeper. So, we've gone and recovered the recall techniques. Let's do the lucid dreaming stuff. For the next 2 weeks, I'd like you to practice one thing throughout the day, at least once every half an hour. I want you to look at your hand, and I want you to ask yourself that question. Am I dreaming or awake right now? Am I dreaming or awake right now? When you've asked that, make a command. Hand, disappear now! Don't vocalize it, especially if you're out and about. So, only once every half an hour. And you can incorporate this in your regular routine. So as you're putting on your clothes in the morning, you're using your hands. Am I dreaming or awake right now? Hands disappear now. As you go through doors, how many doors do you go through in a day? Every time you go through a door, you can look at your hand. You can do it in a very casual, nonchalant way in your mind. Am I dreaming or awake right now? Hand disappear now. Doesn't disappear, you're away from reality. Of course it's not going to disappear, but the point here is you're conditioning yourself, you're programming yourself for this 2-week period. There's going to come a point within a dream where suddenly you're going to see your hand, and it's going to click, and you're going to make that simple, am I dreaming or awake right now, hand disappear now. Oh, oh shit! I'm dreaming. And suddenly you're sat there, and you're probably getting very, very excited. Don't get too excited. Fear and excitement will stop that dream in its tracks. And you'll suddenly become aware of your physical room. You might have astral sight for a few moments, and then it's gone. Kaput. Keep your fear and your excitement in check as best you possibly can. Another great system, beyond the hands one, because the hand ones takes a lot of dedication. Another really good one is coming back to an alarm system. Get yourself a computer alarm, a PC alarm. You can download the software free of charge online. Just go into Google, type in free PC alarm, free computer alarm. And you can set this thing to go off at intervals. If you have somebody that lives with you and sleeps in the same bed with you, probably not a good idea. But if you have some headsets, then just use those, maybe a laptop next to on your desk, your bedside table. I actually have developed a little piece of software that uses isochronic tones, much more powerful than the hemi-sync technology I was talking about earlier. This stuff will entrain your brain much quicker to the theta frequencies that I use within the track. And what it's designed to do is to keep you, after the 6-hour period, I don't recommend that you use it unless you've had 6 hours of sleep. After you've had 6 hours of sleep, you wake up, maybe go to the toilet, because what you don't want is to have a distraction after you get back into bed and your bladder suddenly like, hello, hello, I have to have a pee. You don't want to get back into a trance state and then suddenly have to break that state. So the routine is, you get up, 6 hour mark, go to the toilet, maybe you go downstairs, you're having yourself a quick little drink of juice or water, 2 or 3 ounces maximum. And then you have maybe a small snack, like a piece of fruit or 1 or 2 biscuits. And this is to stop your tummy rumbling while you're trying to get into a trance state. You don't want any sort of distractions. You then get back into bed, you either use the computer, the free alarm system, and you set it at intervals, maybe once every half an hour. Once every half an hour, an alarm will go off, and it'll just go off the once, and then hopefully it'll, if you download the right stuff, you won't have to switch it off. It'll just alert you, and then it'll go off again. When you hear the alarm, you stay completely still. Don't move. Don't even open your eyes. At that point, try to remember a dream that you just had. Maybe you actually, like you probably experienced in your life, heard the alarm while still in a dream. If that's the case, then that's when you want to definitely use, you know, the state testing. Look at your hand. Am I dreaming or awake? Hand disappear now. In the dream state, your hand will always disappear. In a consensus environment like Christian heaven, your hand will always disappear. Without fail, it will disappear. Walls, cars, making those things disappear, change color, you can't depend on them. The hand in the out-of-body state, you can always depend on. Make it morph, make your fingers become, you know, very, very long. And so always the hands. If you want to make it easy on yourself and you do want to kind of have the track that I've designed specifically for this, I've got cards up here, you can take one of those, get in contact with me, and I'll let you know what I've got for purchase. They're only cheap, 15, 25 pounds, depending on which track you want. So, you can use the alarm system, you can use the hands for the next 2 weeks just to program yourself. Once you start becoming lucid within a dream state, you can do whatever you'd like to do. You're limited only by your imagination. You do not have to be stuck with the dream you're in. If you wake up in the middle of a field, wow, it's lovely to be realized that you're conscious and you're standing here in the middle of this green emerald field, but how would you like to maybe be snow skiing down Mount Fuji? How would you like to go and visit the Great Pyramids? How would you like to maybe do something really interesting and make an out-of-body command and do something like, say, oh, I don't know, something simple and innocuous like, higher self now! Demand! Make a command to see higher self. Experience your true self. When I made that command in the past from a lucid dream or the out-of-body state, man, oh man, the bizarreness that takes place. If that's experiencing higher self from the soul plane in its raw energy state, pure consciousness, or experiencing it in the form of a guide aspect that comes to visit me on the astral planes, it's a lovely command. Or you can just, within the lucid dream state, make another simple command, out of body now. If you realize you're on the astral plane already, you're just wrapped around your own thought form, wrapped in your own thought form, your own fantasy overlay, ask to see the astral plane in its proper form. So, astral plane now.
Now I experience the astral plane. Your dream will dissipate, and hopefully you'll be standing there, either in one of the consensus environments or non-consensus environments, and you can do what you like. If you'd like to visit Christian heaven, go for it. If you'd like to visit Christian hell, sure, why not? If at any point you feel, how do I get back to my physical body? All you need to do is think about moving a finger, wiggling a toe. Even thinking about your physical body is good enough. If you can get out of body, I wouldn't think about your physical body, because you will come right back. You will snap right back into your physical body. It's like a fail safe. You might think, well, okay, another fear-related, important fear-related thing to cover. People are convinced that if I leave my physical body, I'm leaving this empty vessel and something can jump into it. As I've already covered, the soul is not contained here within the physical body. The soul is much more dynamic for that. It's animating this physical body with its consciousness. So when you go out of body, unconsciously or consciously, that same animating force, that continuum of consciousness, spirit, is still animating that physical body. Nothing can jump into it. In a true possession, that's not what's taking place. That's something different entirely. And I don't think we're going to be able to get to something like that tonight. But you do not need to fear the out-of-body state. It is the one thing that people fear most, is having these out-of-body experiences, because it's akin to death. What happens if I get out of my body and I can't come back and I die when I'm out of body? You know what? That can happen. But that's probably down to your soul contract. That's your fated exit moment. You just happen to be somewhere other than your physical body when it took place. Fact of life. Get over it. Sorry. I don't mean to be so flippant.
Can I just ask you?
Sure. Oh, before you do, can I, on that flippant note,
right?
One thing I find, this is one of the biggest lessons I've learned. This is one of the biggest pieces of the puzzle which I've discovered. Sense of humor. Not taking yourself or life too seriously. This truly is an illusion. The deeper you go on this journey, the more you'll realize how much of an illusion this really is. When I get out of body and I find myself on these higher planes of consciousness, and I'm interacting with my own soul, or I'm interacting with more evolved beings, this wicked, wicked sense of humor that they have is incredible. Because they're trying to impart, you're taking yourself too serious. You're taking the illusion too serious. It is an illusion. You're rediscovering that it's an illusion. So calm down. You don't have to get all, you know, boiled up in the semantics anymore. This is why I don't have a political bone in my body anymore. This is why I couldn't give two hoots about conspiracy-related stuff like, you know, is there really an ET spaceship, an underground base at Area 51? I don't care anymore. I have much more interesting things to discover. Much, much more interesting things to discover. We truly are inspirational beings. At your core, you are unlimited. It is only you, through your physical conditioning and programming, that you have become more limited in your nature. If you're here tonight, which you are, you really are, maybe take some of these tools that I've shared with you. Maybe go online and find some other tools that go along with these. A really good resource is a website called lucidology.com. A book that I would like to recommend, I can remember it off my head, it's by a chap named Robert Wagoner. That's W-A-G-G-O-N-E-R, Wagoner. And the title of the book eludes me, but just type in Robert Wagoner, Lucid Dreaming, into Amazon, and his book will come up. It is an amazing book on the subject of lucid dreaming. He also touches on the out-of-body state. A book I'd like to recommend, which I mentioned earlier, for more study for the out-of-body state, is Adventures Beyond the Body by William Buhlmann. Buhlmann is spelled B-U-H-L-M-A-N. You will not find a better mentor, teacher for the out-of-body state. He is phenomenal. A few of my friends who've sat in my out-of-body workshop, went to see William Buhlmann in Italy recently for his workshop. Buhlmann, like I said earlier, is 60 years old. He's had 40 years of OBE experience. He said in the early days, when he was getting out of body and he had a few of these non-human intelligences, aliens, ETs, that were manipulating him while out in the out-of-body state, he said that doesn't happen anymore. When he goes out of body now, he's become so powerful after 40 years of these journeys. He said nothing gets in his way. He blasts through everything. Absolutely nothing stands in his way of finding the truth. And this is one thing I think is very important for you when you start this journey and you start finding these non-physical humans or other astral wildlife or non-physical entities that might be charlatans or they might try to harm you. First and foremost, what I would recommend is love. It is the most, single most powerful energy in the universe. Pure love energy. Beam a little bit of love energy to one of these beings, because ultimately they are an aspect of you. On a deeper level, there is only oneness. There's no separation. That's just part of the duality, the illusion we experience here. There is only oneness. So ultimately that is an aspect of you. And it might actually be an aspect of you subconsciously generated, part of the shadow people talk about, this subconsciously suppressed stuff that just sits there, surfaces through dreams. It will surface in the out-of-body state too. It's an excellent opportunity for reintegration. To, you know, walk up to these, maybe these fire-spitting, you know, entities and give them a hug. Ultimately, they can't hurt you. If they start to hurt you, think about your physical body. Most of them haven't got a clue about energy mechanics and principles. They know their environments and they know nothing else. Think about going to a higher plane. Think about light. Think about your own higher self. You'll teleport away from them before you know it. If you can't teleport away from them, if they really won't leave you alone, and if love's not doing the trick, the one thing that you do have again, like your hands, being able to manipulate your hands, you are in charge of your form. Command yourself to be as big as Godzilla. Shoot fire from every orifice and freak this being out. If you really can't take love for an answer or no for an answer, freak them out. No big deal. They'll live to fight another day. But first and foremost, I recommend love. One of the things that, biggest lessons I've learned this year, unconditional love and acceptance, to validate everything. I recently was on a train in London going to give a talk on unconditional love and acceptance. And on this train, I was focused, I was in my center, in meditation, on unconditional love and acceptance, radiating this beautiful energy to everybody else on the train. We suddenly pull up to Wembley Park train station, and all these football fans pile in from a day out at Wembley. And they're chanting all these malicious chants, and they pull me right out of my center, and I'm cursing them under my breath. And I'm thinking, wow, you spiritual snob. I thought, here I am. What am I doing? I'm judging, which is lowering my vibrational energy, and I'm being righteous, which is lowering my vibrational energy. I could just feel it going, ooh. And in that moment, I recentered myself, and I looked around me, and I didn't see football hooligans. I saw ascended masters. Because without people who were in deeper amnesia than me, how do I go higher in my development? Who's there to push me to go higher? Ascended masters. All around me on that train were ascended masters in that moment. I was in deep, deep gratitude. Recentered myself, and I, again, centered myself on this acceptance of all. Because if we truly are creating, co-creating this reality, we have to validate everything. Absolutely everything. Stop labeling good and bad. We're more than that. We're more creative than that. If you react to something somebody does, take it as an opportunity. They've mirrored your growth to you. This is what we do with each other. We mirror our growth and we reflect our beauty and perfection. If there's anything that somebody does that aggravates you, it's an opportunity, it's a gift for you to go higher in your developments at that moment in time. We're not here to change each other. We're not here to save the planet. The planet doesn't need saving. The biggest higher self in the soul plane, the most evolved being in this whole energy system, is the Earth consciousness. You might think, well, I've never heard of the Earth consciousness. Why would the Earth not have its own soul? Everything has a non-physical duplicate. The Earth itself is a living being. It has its own higher self, its own soul. What the hell does it take? What kind of evolution must we go through to become the consciousness of the planet?
that harbors billions and billions and billions of souls within this one system. What does it take to be the higher self of the planet? Do you really think the higher self of this planet couldn't flick us off like fleas if it wanted to? You know, here we are screwing up the Gulf of Mexico. Do you honestly believe that was an accident? I don't. When I turn on the news these days and I see something like that, if I turn on the news, I don't get upset about that anymore. I rejoice in this co-creation. I realize that Mother Earth is co-creating with all of us. In somewhere on this planet, there are tree huggers out there. That's their truth at this moment in time. They must save the planet. They must save humanity. That is their truth. It's called validating everything. Hitler, you may not think, whoa, geez, how on earth do you want me to validate Hitler? Do you believe that Hitler has a bad soul? And that there's a renegade soul on the soul plane that's just doing what it wants against the higher will? Or that Hitler soul, that one incarnation, was serving humanity in some way, allowed us to go higher in our own spiritual development? People talk about light and darkness. That's duality. There is no darkness. There is no light. There's only oneness. You're either in the camp of separation or in the camp of oneness. Where do you want to be? You're a human, so yes, of course you see separation. We're all human. We experience that. But at the core of who and what we really are, there's oneness. On the soul plane, there's equality. Those individuals on that train with me that day, they may not have been more spiritually aware within this reality as I am at that moment in time, but some of their souls could be more advanced and developed on the soul plane than mine. And they chose to come to serve spiritual snobs like me to go higher in my development. Amen, brothers and sisters. We'll take some questions, and I think we're going to have to wrap it up.
Yes.
Can I ask two questions? The first one is, are you saying that we can really go and hang out with our loved ones at night? You know, like if someone's passed over and we're really grieving.
I am saying that.
Right, that's reassuring. And the other question is, spirit babies that haven't been born yet.
Sorry, spirit who?
Spirit babies, you know, souls that are about to incarnate onto the earth.
Yeah.
Have you ever gone up and met them, or do you know where they hang out, or what it's like?
There's a very interesting place that exists just on the fringe of the astral planes and these higher planes of consciousness. Robert Monroe calls it Focus 27, and this is kind of the re-entry point for souls. Not souls, remember, aspects of a soul. Just one aspect of a soul's overall consciousness to get compressed and then have this experience. But I'll leave that for you to find. Just if you get out of body and you want to find where, you know, this aspect of soul starts its kind of integration for physical reality kind of experiences, just say to yourself, go and acquaint yourself with Robert Monroe's work, in particular his second and third books. Second book is Far Journeys. Third book, Ultimate Journey. Acquaint yourself with those books so you're understanding his label, Focus 27, and when you get out of body, demand to go to Focus 27, and you can see some very interesting stuff. Also in Focus 27, you can come into contact with a lot of ETs who are here to witness this raising of consciousness that seems to be taking place across the world. Jerry, you had a question?
Yeah, you talked quite a bit about the...
Can you speak up, Jerry, please?
Oh, sorry. I usually do. Everybody tells me to keep quiet. I usually project too much. You've talked quite a lot about the astral plane. Mm. And waiting, you know, I was hoping you'd talk about. And the only thing we can do is give an example.
Sure.
When the mother passed over, with a lot of physical suffering, which meant suffering from herself and the family, obviously, watching someone die and struggling for breathing and all that has its impact on the mind and the body.
Absolutely.
And in that aspect, there's got to be a healing of the body and mind, ultimately.
Yeah.
I was very privileged, very fortunate to go out, very blessed that my mother returned within only about 2 months, 7 weeks, full of light, not on the astral plane, because she was a lovely soul, she helped me. 30 years younger, and it just, the whole bedroom lit up, it was so beautiful.
Yeah.
It was like in another dimension. So I'm not pointing to me in that, I'm only saying that beyond the astral plane, and beyond meeting these so-called creatures, all right, we can do that.
Yeah.
But there are the ones that give guidance, healing, blessings, wisdom, love, light, to lift us up the very morning after, my mind and my little mind and body were completely healed. Because we were so stressed out and suffering from another, and I couldn't get rid of it. That was completely transformed, transmuted. Now that's only an example. But all I'm saying is many people I meet have these experiences.
Absolutely.
Ordinary people.
Absolutely.
Not mystics, not saints.
Oh, absolutely.
So all I'm saying is a lot of these, if you want to call them spirits, not ghosts. I know Paul Piggies, they're usually children that come back. It's not, you know, anything bad usually. But when you meet your loved one, whatever it is, or your soul partner, whatever, then it's a blessing, you're uplifted, the consciousness is elevated.
Yeah.
And back to what you said originally about our true nature and who we are, surely in a simple way, body, mind, and spirit.
Our truest nature isn't body at all.
Not body. An eternal being is a spirit. No, but what I mean is we've got a vehicle, a body.
Yes, these are tools of consciousness, yes.
Right. So we've got the matter, we've got the body, you know, the matter, the energy. We've got the intelligence, the mind, and all the brains come within the body aspect.
Yeah.
And then we've got the consciousness of the spirit.
Yeah.
Once that sort of stick, oh my goodness, I have a glimpse of my true nature and identity. Only a glimpse. But it's enough to drive us on.
Enough to inspire you to go deeper, absolutely. And Jerry is right. One thing that you mentioned, your mother being 30 years younger. Think about any social network sites.
That was in a spiritual body, not in a physical. You know.
Think about just physical for the moment. How on social networking sites like Facebook, we all have younger images of ourselves, profile pictures. What happens in non-physical reality is people learn about this this thought response nature of reality, and they look in a non-physical mirror and think, ooh, I'll change this, and they make themselves more beautiful because of their strong self-concept of who they are. Especially, we all have this kind of threshold, this kind of peak part of our life where we identify ourselves with this younger version of ourselves. Even when we get older, we start to kind of really identify with that younger version of ourselves without the wrinkles and everything else. When people are out of their bodies permanently, absolutely, they transform into this younger concept of who they identify themselves with. So if you see a relative, a loved one who is much younger, don't think that you're being tricked. It's just that they have the power to transform their appearance. If they don't even want to look like that, they can morph into any kind of form they want to. But in most cases, they're going to come back as how you identify with them, but probably without a few years on them. Also, you mentioned about your mother transforming in such a amazing way, which helped you heal. My friend Jurgen, who has these 40 years of out-of-body experiences, lives in Worthing. He was telling me about an experience he recently had on the low astral plane. He came to this place where all he could see is these zombies, these non-physical humans walking around like zombies in this very low vibrational plane of reality. Skin, you know, flesh falling off their form. And he went up to this one woman who was very confused and disorientated, and he started to walk with her. And he could see some light in the distance, and he knew that was just vibrational, a vibrational shift. And he was walking her towards this. And the more he walked her towards this, the more she started to transform. And he said just within minutes, she had completely transformed from this zombie-like figure to this reanimated, beautiful human being. He basically did a soul retrieval. He'd just taken her from this darkness in this lower vibrational field into a higher plane of reality. And he was obviously allowed to take her there, again, because of her soul. Her soul knew it was that time to kind of move away from that low vibrational environment. Whatever lessons whatever thing she was there for, she'd obviously learned it. Consciously or unconsciously, she's gone through it, and it was time to move on. Powerful stuff. Anybody else questions before we wrap up?
Can I ask about 2012, what your theories on that? And why,
saying
like, why are we incarnated at this time?
Okay, just to be brief. In the out-of-body state, yes, I am witnessing some serious non-physical support that's being put into place. There does seem to be some sort of activity in regards to this ascension process. First and foremost, I would say don't focus on a date. People did it with Y2K, people have done it many times in the past. Don't be date-focused, don't be end-results-focused. It's kind of like a black hole. You don't suddenly come to the event horizon and get grabbed by the gravity and think, oh shit, how do I get out of this? Same goes with any sort of raising of consciousness. We feel the effects before the event horizon, before 2012. We're feeling the effects of that now. We're feeling the raising of consciousness across the board. Ultimately, people are starting to struggle in ways that they've never struggled. They're holding on to low vibrational patterns that no longer serve with these new dynamic energies that have entered the system. What is this dynamic energy ultimately? It's like what during our conversation during the break. It's just a more evolved, more dynamic form of love. You know, a form of love that is impacting this system. You can call it love, you can call it light, you can call it what you want. Same as before when we were talking the difference between the soul and the spirit and everything else. We were talking about the same thing, Jerry, but we're using human labels that gets in the way of the fact that, you know, we are talking about the same thing. Same thing with love and light. They are the same thing. When people sign off their emails with love and light, it's synonymous. It is the one of the same energy. It is the most powerful energy in the whole of creation. At least as I've come to be aware so far. I will probably be wrong, and I can't wait to be shown that I'm wrong, because that's an evolution of truth. And a very important thing to kind of, we won't quite end, but unless we're ready to get kicked out, but to always allow yourself to practice non-attachment, not just from physical stuff, material stuff, but more importantly, your own belief systems, your assumptions, and what you think to be truth. If you ever catch yourself saying this is the ultimate truth, no. You've just limited yourself and the universe. If the universe is all about having experiences to help it expand itself, to learn more about itself, to grow, how can it be limited? How can you say there's an ultimate truth? Maybe there's an ultimate truth within this one corridor of consciousness, within the Earth Life system. One truth, but not for all of creation. All of creation is always about expansion, infinite expression. There cannot be an ultimate truth. So be willing to practice non-attachment with what you feel is truth. The more you hold on to what you feel is truth, the less it will evolve. There's always going to be a higher plateau of truth. Once you've mastered one plateau of truth, you'll start to attract yourself and evolve to that higher plane. You'll then start to struggle with that new truth. You're not being irresponsible. You're just struggling with a level of truth that, you know, is new to you. Eventually you'll master that, you'll go to another plateau of truth. This is an eternal experience that we're having. The universe, creation, it's eternal. It's infinite. I hear people say, I can't wait to go home. You are home. You are an aspect of the universe. You are an aspect of creation. Whether you perceive yourself to be on the fringe or the core, you are home. Don't waste time on dates. How much power have you given to time? How much power have you given away to space? Oh, that didn't even answer anything about 2012, did it? if we've got time afterwards, and you know, because I'm sure you've got to clean up and get us out of here, I'm happy to address it further. I do have a kind of my own theory on it, based on some other stuff with some other people's work, which makes a lot of sense. But ultimately, it is this greater energy that's impacting on our reality. It does have to do with an alignment with the galactic center. A lot of people theorize that. Out-of-body explorers are seeing there's truth in that. And there's also truth with other alignments, such as, I'm not going to go there. I was going to touch on things as simple as the Bermuda Triangle, which isn't that simple at all. But
I just wondered if you can articulate consciousness in the soul plane.
So far I've had limited experiences in the soul plane, maybe three that I can identify as being the soul plane experiences consciously, aware of that. The first time I was there very briefly, I was aware that I had no form. I was aware that there was no form, period. I felt there was no rush. I didn't feel any of my human aspects at all. I could feel that there was kind of consciousness all around me, but I couldn't explain it. It was incredible, and it was probably because it was my first experience reacquainting myself in a conscious human way, from a human perspective with the soul plane. I've heard of people like Robert Monroe and William Buhlman who have gone to the soul plane, and they've been exposed to that raw energy state of the soul. I've probably experienced that, but I just don't have enough experience to kind of give it any sort of justice. So all I'm going to have to say is that what I experienced seemed to be pure consciousness, no form, no time, no substance of any sort, except for just being aware of some deeper feelings of I didn't feel any, I really felt like it was all me. I felt like it was me, but I knew at the same time it was beyond just me, like some sort of universal consciousness, I guess, that people talk about. It was pretty phenomenal stuff. And that first time I was there, I was then catapulted away immediately into what seemed like a past life experience, and that was pretty amazing. So I think I probably touched on the Akashic records when I was there, touched into an aspect of that, but I can't really go much deeper than that. My range of my experience is mainly here, the depth of my experience. A lot of my research now is focused on the soul plane, because I like to go deeper in my kind of understanding of that. So I'm sorry, I can't be much more helpful than that.
You said it's not about light and dark, but about oneness. And a lady who I know, and I've only got her word for what she actually does, but claims to travel at night, but talks about it more in terms of light and darkness, actually says that there's a war going on between the light and the dark, and I'm just wondering how that kind of...
There is, but that's all of this, between the physical plane and these non-physical planes, all the way up to this soul plane, which sits beyond time and space. There are plenty of wars going on. There's intergalactic wars going on. There's all kinds of stuff, interdimensional, you know, wars. Light, darkness, yes, of course. But that's because this whole system is duality. The whole system. Until you reintegrate with the soul plane, where you experience that, that oneness, you are going to experience this. Because again, this is the Earth life system, the human experience. You don't stop being human here. So you experience separation, duality, separation, duality, separation, duality, separation, duality, just on lesser levels. The astral planes and the higher planes of consciousness are rife with, you know, endless numbers of systems of light and darkness, but ultimately it is just that other aspect of us helping us go higher in our development. That's all it is on a deeper level. But if you want to kind of continue to get bogged down with the semantics, that's fine. Those are belief systems, and you're welcome to them. I've got my own belief systems at the moment, which I'm still trying to kind of detach from and kind of evolve through. I mean, for me, it's all about discovering higher levels of truth. Yes, these kind of wars between light and dark do go on, because it is a system of duality.
Do you use any kind of protection when you go through, or do you just trust that you've got that already there? And
that's,
it talks about flying with guides.
What's your name?
Mike.
Mike, that is one of the best questions. I love answering that question. I made fun of Jesus recently, and in one of my emails to my email list, and people got really pissed off and upset about it. I was talking about how, you know, I've got so many friends who they get crystals and they charge crystals with intent to protect themselves. They take incense and they spray it around. They meditate and they root themselves to the earth. And we all do this stuff, okay? So I'm not poking fun of you, but I was poking fun of Jesus. I was saying, I can just imagine this highly evolved being filling his robes with crystals, spraying himself down, rooting himself to the earth before going out and playing with the unwashed masses. And what protected Jesus? What protects a high vibrational being? That's just it, high vibrational energy. Let's say Jesus walks into a pub, okay? And his vibrational energy is way up here. Everybody else's is way down here, lower vibrational energy. His trumps it all, because his energy is higher than theirs. His energy gives, you know, holds the space basically, allows those low vibrational energies and those individuals to move into a higher space. He holds the space. There's nothing that can trump love. Ultimately, how do you get to be a high vibrational being? By practicing unconditional love and acceptance. And this is the kind of the little system for it, if you like. To experience high vibrational energy, you have to have an open heart, your heart center, fully open. A lot of people teach you and train you to work on your chakra system, clean it all up, balance it, and then close it up like Fort Knox. No. First and foremost, what are you protecting yourself from? On a deeper level, you're protecting yourself from yourself. Okay? Come back to this level, you're protecting yourself from the light and the darkness, fair enough. But that's your belief system. If you believe you need to close down your chakra system, guess what? You do need to close down your chakra system. So I'm not trying to belittle your belief systems. That's where you're at in your development. That is your truth right now. And until you evolve that, then yes, maintain that belief system. But what I'm saying is that nothing trumps love. So to get to this high vibrational space, you have to have an open heart. To have an open heart, you practice, to have this open heart, you practice unconditional love and acceptance. The more you practice unconditional love and acceptance, your vibrational energy goes up. On a regular basis, I have meditations where I sit, or I walk, and I do whatever I want, and I unconditionally love and accept myself first and foremost. It is the first thing you must do, yourself. Nobody else. It's not selfish. Religion will teach you that's a selfish practice. Nothing can be furthest from the truth. It starts here. Unconditional love and acceptance of who I am right now at this moment in time. I validate who I am. I then validate everybody else. At that point, I'll then start beaming out this great, I'll open my heart center and allow this non-physical energy, love, light, whatever you want to call it, from the soul plane, draw that straight into my physical body, and I become this beacon of light. I then will push that energy out to anybody and everything, because in this system of the universe, whenever we give, as you know, we receive. And when we give, we don't just receive a little bit more, but and in the giving process, we amplify the energy, and the energy comes back even stronger. So the more you give away this dynamic energy, the more of it you receive. Therefore, the more you can maintain, and the more you can give. And again, it comes back to even more, and you give even more. The more and more you do that, the more your vibrational energy goes to the roof. As a great example, I was with a girl down in Lewis near Brighton recently. Her mother is very superstitious, and that's also obviously been conditioned into the daughter. We were sitting by this river in Lewis, and I said to her, let's do a little demonstration here. And she said, what? I said, okay, get your fingers like this. And so we're both sitting on the riverbanks with our feet dangling over, and I said, kind of get your fingers like this. And she just started to get a little bit worried, what the hell's Todd going to do? And I said, what we're going to do is on the count of three, we're going to put our fingers high in the air, we're going to say, part my language, I can get a bit vulgar. Fuck off, higher self. Okay? Just fuck off. And she was mortified. I can't tell myself to fuck. I can't do that. I said, no, come on, let's do it, let's do it. And so she got ready, and she's sitting there looking really nervous. And one, two, three, and I just went for it, and she hesitated. And then she did it. And as soon as she did it, she backed up a little bit and fell right into a patch of stinging nettles. And she said, I told you I'd get smited. I told you I'd get smited by higher self. I said, why didn't I get smited? Because my higher self, like your higher self, has a sense of humor. Ultimately, I am higher self. Ultimately, I am the soul. But I'm not taking life too seriously. I have this joy, this love in my heart that allows me to have this high vibrational energy. I didn't fall into the stinging nettles. She did. Because that's my belief system, that if she angers God or herself, she's going to be smited. Stop taking life and yourself too serious.
Is snoring forgivable? No, it's not, is it? I
can't. Especially in my
however high I go, I can't get past snoring.
Not at all. Snoring's all good.
You're talking about out-of-body experiences. I had a motorcycle accident 24 years ago. Head-on collision with a car. Don't remember anything about the accident apart from getting up and walking around to the driver's door and opening the door and asking if he was okay. I hit the car at 30 miles an hour, head on. The bike went right on the top, I went over. Don't remember anything about it. So how would you explain that? Was that an out-of-body experience?
Probably, first and foremost, near-death experiences, out-of-body experiences, they're the same thing. The physical body during near-death experiences, technically dead, but the animating force is still enlivening that physical body. That's we talked about once again. Jerry and I were busy during the break. We were talking about physical non-physical interface between the physical and non-physical bodies. People, science want to suggest that the mind is here in the brain. Even those with very kind of deep spiritual knowledge might still kind of hold some sort of feeling about the mind. The way I see it now is we have this endocrine system. We have, say, for example, an example is the pineal gland, which relates to the third eye chakra. This endocrine system is directly linked to this non-physical energy system, the chakra system. That's the interface between physical and non-physical. So this animating force works through these non-physical energy centers through the endocrine system. That is the mind. So in this experience where you were able to perceive something that, if I got that correctly, you perceived an aspect of this experience that you shouldn't have done from your current perspective?
No, I just don't remember anything about the accident, apart from walking away without a scratch.
I would say, I mean, it's
possibly just a blackout you experienced, but it could be something more. Mm. I think in a lot of those sort of experiences, we do have the separation. And on that note, very important that you brought up that question. The out-of-body experience, completely, that language is a complete misnomer. We are not having out-of-body experiences. This is very important to understand in your journey for out-of-body experiences. You are not having an out-of-body experience. You are shifting your awareness from one reality to another reality, and you're doing that instantaneously. So when you feel yourself hovering above your, starting to float away from your physical body, feel yourself rolling away from your physical body, feeling yourself sinking down to your bed, there's not something coming out of your physical body and doing that. All that's taking place is your awareness has shifted from physical reality to non-physical reality. In an instant, you're now, your awareness is seated in that energy body, that auric field, that first energy body, and that's what's rolling. That's what's in motion, or perceived to be in motion. You are not having an out-of-body experience, and this is so important for you to understand, because once again, this will help you remove your fears and relate it to the out-of-body state. You are not having an out-of-body experience. You are shifting your awareness from one perspective to another perspective along this continuum of consciousness, which is your spirit, your animating force. You are not having an out-of-body experience. Nothing is coming out of your physical body.
So the next question from that is then, if you wake up in, when you're sleeping in a start, is that when you just come back?
Sorry, when you're sleeping in?
Well, if you just sort of woke up with a start, you've obviously been dreaming about something. You might have dreamt that you've run into the back of something in a car or something, and you just wake up like that.
Mm. When you sometimes wake with this kind of a jolt, or anybody ever have a racing heart sensation when they wake, this is your energy body. You're feeling the effects of your energy body. Your awareness is still partly in the energy body and partly in physical, in the physical. Paralysis. Anybody suffer from paralysis?
Yes, a lot.
Okay, do you want to learn how to break it?
Oh, yeah, right.
Without fail?
It's not happened for a while though, but I used to have enough for
it. If you ever get paralysis again, change your breathing pattern.
Okay,
just make it erratic, make it deep, and as soon as you do that, within 10 seconds, you'll break paralysis without fail. So no matter how deep the paralysis, just change your breathing pattern and it's broken. Simple as that. What is paralysis? It can be several different things. Science can be correct. It's, you know, the nervous system shutting down for the night so you don't act out your dreams and hurt yourself or other people around you. It all makes a lot of sense to me. There are out-of-body explorers like Robert Bruce who suggest that your awareness is partly, in some instances of paralysis, your awareness is more in the energy body than it is in the physical body. So there could be different reasons for it. But paralysis is an excellent kind of a platform for experiencing and having an out-of-body experience, because you can't get the body more relaxed than paralysis. You're in a very, very deep state. So if you keep your, if you wake in full paralysis and you're comfortable within the paralysis, don't move. Don't bat an eyelid. Use some of these techniques that we've talked about. Maybe learn from William Goodwin's book to go deeper with some out-of-body techniques. He's got some good ones. They're not the best in the world, but they're good starting points. So. Did I answer what you... Sorry, I ramble sometimes.
I think with what you were saying about the book, Adventures Beyond the...
Body. Yeah. Yeah. Anybody else?
What's your take on the alien abduction stories?
As far as I'm concerned, I validate it. I've had experiences which can't be explained in any other way. But one interesting thing with what you'll read in Adventures Beyond the Body, William Buhlman... it's got this correlation that he sees, and it makes a lot of sense to me. When people talk about having their abductions and they're levitated, you know, away from a room, they're levitated through walls and ceilings and onto craft, physical bodies can't go through walls, folks. They can't go through ceilings. What's being abducted is your energy body, not your physical body. There are cases where the physical body is obviously going to be abducted, but in the majority of cases, it's your energy body which is being abducted. Because they are interdimensional beings. Yes, they have form. They have home worlds. This soul plane is interconnected to other home worlds throughout our universe. So let's say over here in, what's one of these popular star systems?
Andromeda.
But a particular star in particular, it doesn't matter the star. Somebody else's sun, basically, with a home world. The Sirians, let's use them as an example. With their energy, their knowledge of energy mechanics and principles, they're not going to be traveling interstellarly from star to star. They're going to be traveling interdimensionally.
to arrive to us. It's the quickest way to get to A to B is interdimensionally. So they materialize what they need on arrival. They're that powerful enough to do that. And they do that. And they do interact with the system. You get a body enough, you'll encounter most of them here in the higher planes of consciousness, just parking themselves in orbit around physical Earth in this energy system, learning through this system. I've had a few encounters with the Greys, I've had a few encounters with other intelligences, non-human intelligences. Ultimately, it's up to you. The more conscious you are within the experience, the less effect they can have on you, the less they can manipulate you. Ultimately, who are they?
Us.
On a deeper level, they are us. So once again, if you want to get too bogged down in the semantics of it all, please, by all means, go for it. It's fun. It really is fun stuff to kind of get terrified of being butt probed and such. But ultimately, it is an aspect of us. I warned you, I can't be
before you close, just on a practical level, I know you've got some concern. As we're talking now, there's kids starving to death, millions of them, etc., etc. World pollution, world population. What's your take on this in the sense of healing, the healing of the planet, the healing of the individual?
First and foremost, I would never go out to a starving child. I would never go out to a woman who's been raped and say, you created that on another level of your being. I would never do that.
No.
That's totally irresponsible. First and foremost, like Jerry's pointing out, you must heal first. You must heal these individuals. You cannot walk up to Ethiopians and say, you created this, so deal with it. You heal them. You heal their bodies. You heal their minds. And then we go deeper. So healing obviously is very important. But healing, that's an interesting one. We co-create all of this. All of it. Why do we have to forgive? Why do we have to forgive? Why do we have to heal?
Behold.
There is no healing. On a deeper level, there is no healing, Jerry. It's duality. It's this separation. It's this illusion. There is no healing. This is an illusion. It's an illusion. It's a very powerful illusion. There is no healing. There is no healing. That's your current belief system. There is no healing. That's fine. Belief systems are great starting points.
Are you saying we're already pure?
We are the universe, Jerry. We are an aspect of the universe. We are the constituent parts of the universe. And we're co-creating this reality. This is the end product of thoughts. This is where consciousness emanates from. On a deeper level, it emanates much deeper than that. It really is dynamic stuff. We really are truly inspirational. If you want to get bogged down in all of it, that's fine. To come here and to kind of express this higher self in the flesh, bring this knowledge properly down into the flesh. We don't want to walk around pitying people. We don't want to walk around, you know, in that sort of mindset. Yes, we want to hold compassion because there are people within this journey who are still asleep and we're there to support them. We're there on the edge of their reality, unconditionally, waiting, patiently, loving. This is who and what we really are. The universe really, truly is friendly.
How do you see and deal with death on a personal scale with people who are close to you?
Yes, one of my best friends from childhood committed suicide about 4 years ago, which is one year into my out-of-body exploration. And I tried for the longest time to find him without any success. I was new to a lot of, you know, the energy principles and mechanics. About a year into it, I eventually did find him. I found him in the low astral planes in a community which was pretty nasty stuff. And when he saw me, his face didn't light up that much. He recognized me, but it didn't light up that much. And I then just thought about calling in some sort of help. If I was able to help, then that help will arrive. So I thought about the help that was associated to his energy.
So, sorry, what I meant was, how do you deal emotionally on Earth?
Oh, well, if one of my children died, I'd be devastated. I'd be absolutely devastated because I'm still in the illusion. Make no bones about it. Even with what I've expressed tonight, I'm firmly in this illusion. I would be devastated, but I would also know that that very night I could go out of body and I could find my child and offer some sort of assistance and know that I could still play and evolve in a different way. I would just miss that physical form, no doubt about it. I would be hurt, but I also know that it is an illusion and that ultimately that was a physical meat suit, which is a tool of consciousness and the essence of
you know, that child is not a child. It's an aspect of somebody's soul. Could be an aspect of my own soul. Ultimately, once again, we're here serving each other, and that's whether you think you're serving or not, whether you think somebody you're aware of. I mean, a serial killer, you might think, wow, they're so so vibrationally low, they're just so unevolved spiritually. You don't know that. You honestly don't know that. Mm. You really don't know that. That, again, is spiritual snobbery. Let it go. Detach from that. It is hard, yeah, I have to admit. If that happened, I would be devastated.
If you want to go to the astral planes, do you actually have to be asleep?
No. Clairvoyance is all about the astral plane. Have you ever woken up in the morning and suddenly you could see through closed eyelids, you could see your room, or you could see another environment overlay in your room? That's astral sight. I mean, effectively, that's what clairvoyance is. So no, you don't need to physically leave your body to experience the astral plane.
Should I make it a last question? Can you actually change your fate? You know, if you've been told so by a clairvoyant certain things.
I'm so glad you asked. What a great question to wrap this up with. So going back to soul contract again. I had a guy come to my workshop just 2 months ago, and he said to me, okay, Todd, you've given me these tools, which I'm now thankful for, and I'm going to take these tools, and I'm going to practice, and I'm going to get to the soul plan, and I'm going to review my contract. And he said, but what happens if I get there and I find that 1 month later I'm fated to die? Can I change that? So I put it back to him. I said, why would you want to change that? More importantly, this is your ego wanting to preserve, self-preservation. We all have this strong human survival drive. Of course we don't want to die a month later after discovering that, this. So self-preservation. But think about this on a deeper level, a much, much deeper level. The co-creation. So if you selfishly can change your soul contract, that's going to affect other aspects of souls that are in the system. Let's say that you can't change it. You just have to deal with that fate. I'm not saying you can't change it. I'm just saying, let's say that you can't. So you have that moment and you die. Whose growth in the physical plane? Everybody you leave behind has an opportunity to grow, to develop through that death. You're still human. You've probably not reintegrated with higher self on the soul plane after death. You're probably either here or here. You have a lot of learning to do still. So why deny yourself that just because of an egotistical desire, this deep-seated human survival drive? It's there in all of us. I'm not saying you cannot change your fate. I'm not saying that. I'm just saying, from an egotistical perspective, I can understand why. From this higher perspective, I wouldn't see the need to do it.
Well, right, say if you went to see two clairvoyants and one told you one thing, one told you another.
I didn't know both of them because nobody gives you better advice than your own self. If you want to learn to really activate, these instincts, this authentic advice, you've got the monkey chatter, which is your intellect, your ego, blah, 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 1,000 miles a minute. Higher self, that quiet voice, it's always happy to let the monkey chatter, the ego, the intellect do all it wants. It's got eternity to sit here and wait. And when that quiets down, there's nobody better than you to let that higher self voice, that more authentic voice, to start shining through. And the more, and this is what we started with tonight, trust and having the courage to act. The more you trust these deep instincts and then act, it's so, so important to act. You can't just trust and say, well, I'd like to have that experience, but I don't have the courage to have that experience. Have the courage. Dig deep. Have the experience. Let that conduit between your lower self, your physical self, and your higher self open up more and more. The more you can do that, you won't need psychics, and you won't need anybody else outside of yourself. This is an inward journey, not an external one. You need no one else. All the answers are there. You have a soul. You are the soul. All the souls are parked here. Collectively, they are the Akasic records. Collectively, they have all the knowledge of past, present, future.
Very well. You say that you've got all the answers. How do you answer the question?
Very important. I think to answer the question, it's once again, comes down to ego desires and soul desire. If, for example, with me, I now feel that I am actually on my path. I'm living
you know, my life purpose, if you like. And it's now easier, I find, to manifest the things I need effortlessly. I'm experiencing all the time effortless manifestations because I'm in alignment with my soul, and my ego is more in alignment with my soul. So I think if you find that yourself, you're asking questions, and then you're taking actions, and you're struggling, it's probably an egotistical desire or an egotistical want. If you find that you're starting to materialize things effortlessly, which is the way manifestation should be, then you're in alignment with your soul and what your purpose is. And when you're walking your path, this is the most powerful, I think, advice I can give you, or insights I can give you into the law of attraction, something that just doesn't seem to be taught in any of the schools of the law of attraction. It comes back again to the soul contract. If you were in alignment with your soul, because ultimately the law of attraction is a power of the soul, not a power of the ego. It's a power of the soul. So if you are in alignment with what your soul desires, you will actualize your highest potential within this lifetime. Your highest potential. If you struggle, it's egotistical. If it's effortless, you're in alignment. Ask the question, take an action. If it's struggle, and it might actually be, let's say, for example, you want to manifest £1 million, and let's say you struggle doing that. It may not mean that you're not meant to be a millionaire in this lifetime. It may just mean that right now, at this moment in time, maybe your character development it's not developed sufficiently enough for you to handle that much money within this time period of your life. So it may be on the cards, but not at this moment in time. So if you're struggling at the moment, like I said, let it go, detach from it, ask a new question, have a new experience. And if you're just flowing in this creative flow, it's probably in alignment with your soul. Can't give you any more better advice than that.
So if it's not in alignment, what do you do?
Ask another question. Keep asking questions. Keep going deeper and deeper. And always trust this inner voice, this more authentic voice. You'll learn the difference between the two. There is all that egotistical monkey chatter, and then there is that quiet voice. It's up for you to distinguish which is which, but you do that through taking actions. And if you find yourself more and more taking actions and having less struggle, you're following the right guidance. You'll feel it, you'll know it, you'll have synchronicities, you'll have things so blind, you'll come into your perspective and it just kind of transparently, you know, synchronicity is exposing itself. So, nah, 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 look at me, look at me, look at me. Maybe you've already missed the trail of synchronicity where it starts off, you know, in a very, very kind of insignificant way. It happens all the time. People go on these, oh, by the way, can I just plug this one thing?
Yeah.
I'm doing a synchronicity walk tomorrow night in Manchester City Centre. St. Anne's Square, right up front of the Royal Exchange at 7 p.m. If you want to come out and experience synchronicity in a very powerful, powerful way, then we're going to have a lot of fun. It's £15 each, and we're going to be together until about 9 o'clock, and it is going to be delicious. It really is. We come together with no set format. The whole idea is that you follow your instincts the whole night. There's only two guidelines for the whole night. We walk throughout Manchester, and we're guided with different devices. I have some dice that I'm going to bring with me. One die has somebody rolls it and goes, go left, go right, talk to a stranger. The other one, you know, is for other reasons I won't reveal at the moment. We have these lovely signs that some of you will wear. Oh, I can't believe I just revealed that. There's no signs. We're in a dream. but yeah, so the Royal Exchange, Sand Square, the Royal Exchange, 7 p.m. on the dot, and we're going to have a bucket load of fun. You'll experience synchronicities. We're going to talk about manifestation in a much deeper way. And we're going to draw with chalk on the ground and really kind of go deep with some of these diagrams. There's other people coming from another event that I've organized, so we're going to have a lot of fun. So if you want to experience synchronicity, which I think is one of the most eye-opening tools that these non-physical beings, higher self, use to help us see beyond the veil and experience, reawaken ourselves to who and what we really are. Thank you very much.